Now, the style of the two Talmudim is very different. Talmud Yerushalmi is not very long-winded. The discussions are wrapped up rather quickly and succinctly. There's not a lot of meandering. Talmud Bavli, if you've studied it, the discussions, the Shakla Vitaria, the give and take, the back and forth, is very convoluted. And sometimes it's difficult to keep track. There are digressions. So the question is, which is the superior Talmud? I know we don't like to do that in Judaism. Everybody's equal, everybody's great. But if you had to make some kind of determination, halachically, the halacha was decided in favor of the Talmud Bavli. Because it continued longer, it's later. So it's like the last word, the final word. In halacha, you have a principle, halacha kebatra, that the halacha follows the later authority, because the feeling is that the later authority knows everything that the early authority knew and more. So halacha l'maaseh, we've adopted the Babylonian Talmud, with perhaps the exception of Seder Zeraim, which deals with agricultural laws in Eretz Yisrael, where Rav Kook, for one, says that this should be an exception to the rule, that when it comes to these mitzvot atluyot ba'aretz, which are laid out in Seder Zeraim, which is the first of the six orders of the Mishnah, seeds. And it's much more developed in the Yerushalmi than in the Bavli. I mean, with the exception of Masechet Brachot, you don't have any Gemara Bavli. Whereas you have Yerushalmi, you have the Gemara Talmud Dibnei Mar Rava, you have the Talmud Yerushalmi on Seder Zeraim, on all of these tractates such as Peyad, Bikurim, and Masro that deal with agriculture. So Rav Kook's feeling was that this should be an exception, that when we have to render a halachic decision in regard to the agricultural laws of Eretz Yisrael, that in that case we should defer to the Yerushalmi. But in general, the Bavli won out. What about the style? Most will tell you that the reason that the Yerushalmi is short-winded is there was not time to develop the discussion at greater length. There were a default, there was a history of persecution in Eretz Yisrael that you didn't have in Babylonia. The Jews in Eretz Yisrael were being persecuted, and they couldn't afford the luxury of protracted discussion. They had to wind things up quicker, and then the whole thing was sealed 100 years before the Bavli. That's pretty much the rational approach to the difference of style. That the style of the Yerushalmi is inferior. The brevity is the mark of inferiority.
What year was the Yerushalmi about?
Well, we usually say the Mishnah is 200 CE. You want to say the Yerushalmi is 400, and Bavli 100 years later 500, in a rough and ready manner. But don't quote me. You can quote them. So the feeling is that, sure, the Yerushalmi cuts to the chase, but you know, as I said, that's the mark of inferiority, that people are being persecuted, they don't have the time, they cannot afford the luxury of a long, protracted discussion. And Rav Kook's take is exact opposite. The reason the Yerushalmi cuts the chase is because in Eretz Yisrael you have Ruach HaKodesh. You no longer have Nevuah, classical prophecy, because the last of the prophets, Haggai, Zechariah, and Malachi, signed off at the beginning of the Second Commonwealth, the Bayit Sheni. But you still have in Eretz Yisrael Ruach HaKodesh. And Ruach HaKodesh allows you to make these kinds of snap judgments. Whereas in Bavel, in Babylon, you don't have Ruach HaKodesh. You have Sechel, hopefully. You have reason, you have logic. But, you know, until logic wends its way through the Sugya, and you hear all of the different sides of the issue, it could take a long time. Whereas in Eretz Yisrael, with Ruach HaKodesh, you know, you've got the fast track, express. Now, I ask, where is Rav Kook coming with this? And he's one of the very few to view it this way. As I said, most scholars will tell you that Rav Kook is dead wrong. You know, he's Meshabeach, the signon, the style of the Yerushalmi. He's praising it as a form of Ruach HaKodesh. Nothing of the sort. But where is Rav Kook coming from? And that's what I was saying before. This is a very interesting question. Is he coming from the tradition of Voloshin? Or is he coming from the tradition of Chabad? Now, I don't want to brag, but I'm in a good position to be a chassid of a follower of Rav Kook, because my own family is mixed. I too am a product of this kind of mixed marriage between Hasidim and Misnagdim in Belarus, and there was a lot of that going on. My grandmother's people, their last name was Alperovich, lived halfway between Vilna and Minsk. And within the same family, there were the people who gravitated to the Vilna Gaon, and there were people who were Lubavitcher Hasidim, the Rashab, through Sholem Dov Ber Schneerson. So I'm a very good chassid of Rav Kook. I can appreciate and empathize with what he's going through, this, being pulled to both poles of Vilna and Lubavitch. Not all the people in Merkaz HaRav are that way. I think Rav Moshe Tzvi Neria, who was the biographer of Rav Kook, and he wrote a whole series of biographies of Rav Kook, Sichot HaRaya and Tal HaRaya, I think that he appreciated the Chabad dimension to Rav Kook. But In the present generation, Merkaz HaRav, I think that they're lacking that. And I don't want to brag, but since I too spent some time in Crown Heights during my life, I think that I'm in a position to detect Chabad influence when it's present, in a way that not everyone in Merkaz HaRav is able to. So when it comes to this peculiar view that Rav Kook has of the Yerushalmi versus the Bavli, it's up for grabs. The truth is that his Rosh Yeshiva in Voloshin, Rav Naftali Tzvi Yehuda Berlin, the Netziv, wrote a work Hamek Shela. It's his magnum opus. It's his commentary to the Shiltot, the Rav Chai Gaon. And the preface is called Kidmat HaEmek. And he traces through all of Jewish history, takes you on a tour de force of Jewish history, showing that there have always been these two antipodes of book learning versus divine inspiration. And it starts with the two institutions of the Kohen versus the Shofet in biblical times. You have the Shofet, the judge, on the one hand, who's arriving at halacha based on reason and on sechel, yeah. And then you have the Kohen, who medaber beruach hakodesh, who has divine inspiration and arrives at halachic decisions based on divine inspiration. And the Tziv shows you how those two lines run through all of Jewish history, including Yerushalmi versus Bavli. So maybe Rav Kook got it from Voloshin. And one of the people, Merkaz HaRav, writes this, that that's where Rav Kook is coming from. Maybe. However, I know a little about Chabad. There's a great work by the Mittler Rebbe, Rav Dov Ber, who's the son of the Balatani. This is the second generation leader. It's called Sharei Ora. And in Sharei Ora Hanukkah, there are pages and pages where the Mittler Rebbe, as he was called, the middle Rebbe, is contrasting the Bavli to the Yerushalmi. And the Bavli has to work through the darkness. In fact, the Bavli itself in Sanhedrin of Chaf Dalet Amud Aleph comments on a pasuk that we're going to be reading very soon in Megillat Eicha, Lamentations and Tisha B'Av, V'machashakim Hoshivani K'metei Olam. He sat me down in dark places like the dead. And the Talmud Bavli says, Zeh Talmudah Shel Bavel. This refers to the Babylonian Talmud, which is a very self-deprecating remark for the Babylonian Talmud to make about itself. V'machashakim hoshivani k'meitei olam, Zeh Talmud Bavli. This pasuk, God made me dwell in dark places, refers to the Babylonian Talmud. So the Mittler Rebbe explains what that's all about. That there's two ways that we can arrive at knowledge. One way is through the darkness. And that's the way Talmud Bavli goes at it. And that's tough, that's difficult. And that's what we do in Galut. Whereas in Eretz Yisrael, and this is the Talmud Yerushalmi, which should probably be called Talmud Tveriani, Tiberian Talmud. It's light. You know, you don't have to go through the darkness to get there.